Coming up on the show, we'll take a look at the latest updates to security and compliance across SharePoint and OneDrive, including new site-level conditional access controls, policy to secure sessions on shared systems by configuring session lengths, multi-geo support for the geographic distribution of users within a single tenant, and to take advantage of all these cloud-based capabilities, we'll show you the new SharePoint migration tool to help you bring your content to the cloud. Joined yet again by Bill Baer. Welcome.
Good to be back.
So over the last 6 months, there have been a lot of updates across security and compliance for SharePoint and OneDrive, and we recently covered conditional access and also the introduction of multi-geo support to place the content in your location of choice. Now, you can watch all these shows at the links below.
That's right. A big focus for us right now has really been how we secure your data, both as you're accessing it as well as when you're sharing it. And we've built on that now with more granularity. To that end, as we think about specific scenarios we're investing in, capabilities such as limited browser access on specific sites that may contain confidential information, securing access on public computers by timing out idle sessions, and really support for multi-geo for data residency needs. So here at the tenant level, as you can see, we have a policy configured that allows full access on unmanaged devices. However, if we switch over to a site that inherits that policy, as you can see, we have the full suite of commands available to us. So if I select this document, as you can see, I have download, share, and I can open the document in Word Online, as well as the rich client. The improvement that we've made is I can now configure another site collection for a more restrictive policy. So on this particular site, in the same tenancy, as you can see, the user's notified that the organization doesn't allow them to download, print, or sync using this particular device. And similarly, as the other site, if I select the document, as you can see, I have fewer commands available to me.
Right, and this really helps users stay productive while on an unmanaged device, but what if I'm on a public or shared computer like a kiosk? Is there anything else that we can do there?
Sure. Here in the ISE, as you can see, we have a new PowerShell commandlet called set SPO browser idle sign out. I can set the value to true, and then I can set a specific warn after and sign out after interval. In my particular scenario, I'm setting the warn after to 30 seconds and the sign out to 60 seconds. That will warn the user and subsequently sign them out after 60 seconds. Now, in a production scenario, you'd really want this to be 10 to 15 minutes. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at the result. I can switch over to a browser and sign in as a user. And what'll happen, as soon as that session becomes unattended or idle, the user will be warned that they're about to be signed out of Office 365. And then after the threshold's been met that I set earlier, the user will be signed out, as you can see here on the screen.
So again, you're probably gonna wanna set these policies to be 10 or 15 minutes before they log out. And this really ensures that people can't leave a session running. So another person maybe that has access to that shared computer, might be in a hotel business center or something, they won't be able to access the resources in SharePoint.
Right, one of the most common cases we see today is access through public devices, kiosks or terminals and shared systems. So this really helps to ensure that those unattended sessions are expired properly.
So data residency is really an important requirement that really prevents, if you can't do it, people from moving to the cloud. Can we take a look?
Sure, but just a step back, in case you're not familiar with multi-geo, it's really about having a single tenant and that tenant being able to span across multiple geographic locations. For example, if an organization today has Office 365 OneDrive content in North America, and let's say they're expanding their business globally and becoming a multinational company, and they have a need to store OneDrive and SharePoint data in perhaps Europe, Asia, and Australia, admins can now use the multi-geo capabilities to achieve this global reach. Let's take a look at some of the new support we've added, though, since we discussed this scenario previously in the show. In the past, you've only been able to define assignment of a specific geo with new users. And now what we're doing is we're extending that support for moving existing users across geographic regions. So for example, in this organization, Sasha has a OneDrive hosted in North America. And let's say he's moving to Europe for their new role in the European subsidiary. With a simple process, I can move Sasha from North America to Europe using a new Windows PowerShell commandlet, as you can see here in the ISE. It's called start SPO user and content move. And we have a parameter associated with that called destination data location. In this particular case, since we're moving Sasha from North America to Europe, we'll go ahead and set that value to Europe as specified here. You can also see we can set the user principal. So in my case, since we're moving Sasha, it's Sasha at contosowork demo.onmicrosoft.com. Let's go ahead and run it and see what happens.
So will there be any impact to the user then after you've moved their content?
No, as you can see here, the move's in progress. And let's go ahead and take a look at their OneDrive for Business web UX. We'll flip over here. And as you can see, we're at contoso-workdemo-my.sharepoint.com. Since we're moving, let's go ahead and refresh it. Once refreshed, as you can see, the user is notified that their online files are being moved to the new data location as set by the administrator through me running that Windows PowerShell commandlet. And all through this, their OneDrive for Business is set to a read-only state.
So what happens then once the migration completes?
So what happens first in this process is if we look at the OneDrive for Business sync client, you'll notice that there's been no interruption to the sync itself. So we have continuous sync activity regardless of the move state of this particular user. And really to answer your question as to what happens once the move's complete, all we have to do is refresh now, and let's see if the move's completed. And Sesha's move's completed, as you can see, has indicated that that bar is no longer at the top of the screen. You'll also notice one other important change. Instead of contoso-workdemo-my.sharepoint.com, it's contoso-workdemo-eur-my.contoso.com, which indicates that Sesha's been moved between North America and Europe.
Now, if Sesha's shared some links out maybe to some colleagues, what happens then?
Yep, and that's a great question, because what I've done here is I've opened up PowerPoint. And as you can see in the most recently used file list, the file here that Sesha recently used still points to the old URL. However, if I select that particular file and open it up, it'll continue to function. And all of this happens behind the scenes. So not only with most recently used files, but also sharing link. So there's really no loss of access to data.
So no real loss in terms of access to the user or the team members where they've shared their OneDrive docs. Everything's just working.
That's right. Other than that brief period of read-only, even at the time, the user can continue to work with their synced files. They can continue to work with the Office clients. And additionally, all these admin actions of triggering a user move are also logged in the Office 365 audit logs so that compliance officers can really go back and look if they need to.
So we've just moved a user's OneDrive across geos. Mm-hmm. Are there any other functional capabilities coming up in a multi-geo?
Yes, absolutely. There's many more. For example, one of the ones we're adding is support for multi-geo unified search. And that way, users don't need to search each geographic location discreetly for content. The search indexes at rest are always isolated in their respective geos, and they include their associated metadata, but it's really a unified experience.
So with multi-geo, then, we've addressed data residency needs, and in doing so, we're hopefully helping unblock global rollouts. Are we doing anything, though, to help IT migrate their on-prem content to the cloud?
Exactly. So with all of these updates in security and compliance, we've blocked many of the concerns IT has with things like data residency to allow them to move their data to the cloud. So in addition to some of these foundational changes we've made, we're also delivering a new SharePoint migration tool. So if you're an organization that needs to move content from on-premises to the cloud, you can really use this tool with your on-prem SharePoint sites or even your file shares and even target the geography where you want to move your data. In this scenario, however, what I'm going to do is move from a file share to OneDrive for Business. This is the new SharePoint migration tool on the screen. So all I have to do is click Next and then authenticate against Office 365 using my Office 365 account. So we'll go ahead and enter the credentials and choose to sign in and authenticate against Office 365. I have a number of options I can choose from, as I mentioned, SharePoint sites, file shares, even CSVs for bulk migrations. In this example, let's go ahead and take the file share option. So I can click File Share. I can choose the folder I want to move, Contoso Documents in this case. I click Next, and then I can specify the URL. In our example, we're going to choose OneDrive for Business. So I'm going to specify a OneDrive for Business URL, and then I'm going to select a document library. We'll choose Documents in this case, and we'll add it to the migration queue. Once added, it's as simple as clicking Migrate. And throughout this process, I can keep apprised of the migration itself. So I can choose this caret here, and it shows me how many files have been migrated in addition to how many bytes, and gives me an option to view a more detailed task report. So the content is now migrating, as we speak, from a file share to OneDrive for Business. And this really allows me to target a specific geographic as well. And here we are with the completed migration. Today, if you see what we have here, we're focused really on file shares and document libraries. But for more complex migration scenarios, we have Fast Track or existing partners that our customers can work with.
So now, what happens then if I have to migrate thousands or tens of thousands of users and lots of data?
This tool provides the ability to take a CSV file as an import for bulk migration scenarios. And we're continuously working to ensure that these migrations, regardless of their size, even if you have hundreds of terabytes of data, can happen within just a few weeks. And the best thing about all of this is it's free, it's simple, and it's fast.
So lots of really great updates for SharePoint admins to protect data, address data residency requirements, and migrate data. But what's next?
What I've shown you kind of here today through these demonstrations is a subset of the latest controls we've built. But we're going to continue to evolve along with technology trends with more fine-grained controls, from the tenant level and the site level, as you saw today, all the way down to the file level in the future.
And of course, we're going to be tracking all of these updates as they happen on Microsoft Mechanics. But where do people go to learn more and really start playing with what they're seeing today?
So the OneDrive for Business multi-geo experience I showed you, it's available today in preview. If you're interested, you can learn more at the link below. All of the rest of the controls I've showed you will be rolled out to preview soon. And lastly, the SharePoint migration tool is available in preview to download today.
So thanks, Bill, for a really great overview. And keep checking back to Microsoft Mechanics for the latest tech updates across Microsoft. Goodbye for now.